So this was why it provided for a center with limited power, provinces with more autonomy and geographical expression for the Muslims in the form of B and C provinces. So as I already told you that there was plan for minorities, and this plan was to remove the dissension part in between Hindus and Muslims. Now, however, it was a genuine attempt, but definitely not the last. This was the genuine attempt, but not the last attempt, because we again saw that Lord Mountbatten was here to dilute the dissensions between the Congress and Muslim League. In fact, the formation of interim government in September 1946 with the Congress and the League together sharing the power can be called the last attempt. Now, the last attempt is also explained here so that we can conclude the answer. Now, let's get into the conclusion. The main objective of cabinet mission was to find out ways and means for the peaceful transfer of power in India, to suggest measures for the formation of a constitution making machinery, and also to set up interim government. So these were the main aspects of the cabinet mission plan, and overall the main purpose was to diffuse the tension between All India Congress and Muslim League so that bifurcation of state do not occur. Okay, so this was the main purpose of the cabinet mission plan. But have we done justice with the question? Now, the question was, the cabinet mission plan was the last genuine attempt to preserve the unity and integrity of India. What we have done is, we have explained the purpose of the mission. From the purpose itself, we have established the fact that unity and integrity was to be maintained. We have explained the features of the cabinet mission plan, where we again came to a conclusion that Pakistan was not to be separated. And then again, in the later part also, we come to a conclusion that the features itself were advocating for the unity and integrity of India, and it was not advocating about the separation of India. Okay, so this is the perfect answer. If it is of 15 marks, I will definitely say that for around 10 to 11 marks, definitely you are going to get in this particular question. Okay, so we will move on with the other question. This particular question is related to art and culture, and from the question itself you will get a kind of idea that what you are going to explain. Now let's read the question. Interactions between common Hindus and Muslims, Sufi and Bhakti saints created an environment for the emergence of Hindustani culture. Now this question is about the confluence of Hindus practices and Muslims practices, and how these involvement of different practices of different sects or different religion made out to be found as Hindustani culture. So this is the main aspect of the question that has to be explained. How exactly the practices from Muslims and practices from Hindus confluenced, and how Sufi or Bhakti saints created an environment where we could see that there is a kind of emergence of Hindustani culture. Now that has to be elucidated, which means that a crux part of this point has to be made out here. Now let's know what is the demand of the question. Connections established between religions existing in India. The religions which existed, the prominent religions which existed, and those were Islam and Hinduism. Coming of Islam and dilution in its hard and orthodoxy. As we see that when the first Muslim ruler came into India, it was actually following the orthodoxy and beliefs that that were entailed by the Islam. So this was the main purpose, the main perspective behind conquering India. So the perspectives that were present in Islam, thoughts and ideas, were of orthodox in nature, and those orthodox nature were brought in by the foreign invaders. Changes in Hinduism because of other religions. As I already told you that Hinduism was widespread throughout India, and when the foreign invaders invaded India, the thoughts, the ideas, the practices that were involved with those foreign invaders, those also affected the religion of India, and particularly Hinduism, because it was widespread. Now let's start with the answer. Interaction between Hinduism and Islam started with the Arab conquest of Sindh, continued uninterrupted, leading to the emergence of mixed and composite culture called Hindustani. So from this first sentence itself, we can make out that the confluence of practices that were done by Hindus and Muslims, that was actually giving the Hindustani culture support. Now, Islam was influenced by the Hindu Vedanta, devotional music, Buddhist meditative techniques, and Jain Yoga Shastra. So, Islam, which was present in Persia, was quite different from the Islam that was present in Saudi Arabia. And the rulers who were conquering India were actually had their origin in the Saudi Arabian part, or even a small group of people were also had origin in Persia. So from there, we can continue with the answer. Consequently, a reformist movement, Sufism, started within Islam. Likewise, Islam questioning Hinduism on caste inequalities, idolatry, polytheism, led to the Bhakti movement within Hinduism. So what Islam did not have were castes, and what Hinduism had was casteism. Casteism was a very evil practice that were part of Hinduism, whereas Islam did not have casteism or any other evil practice, but remained with orthodoxy belief. This was the main fundamental problem of Islam. But when Islam came with the conquerors, the Islam questioned the practices of Hinduism, and when these practices were questioned, the many people from Hinduism actually adopted the brotherhood aspect of the Islamist or Islam religion itself. Now, contact between the two cultures of Hinduism and Islam started much earlier, as with coming of Islam to India, but the interaction quickened after Islam arrived. When the conquerors were in India, when the rulers of India were Muslims, the practices that they used to do, propagated throughout India. And when those practices were propagated, Hindus or even other religions or other small religions, they were pressurized to accept those changes. And when those changes came into Hindus, came with Hindus, a kind of culture was developed that was called as Hindustani culture. Now, it is true that some bigoted ulama such as Nasiruddin Mubarak Ghaznavi of the regime of Iltutmish advocated a policy of inveterate hostility towards the Brahmins of Hindu community, but other aspects from Hindu religion improved Islam in their own. Even the many aspects of Hindu religion was also helping reform Islam, but a particular movement was never started to go against the orthodoxy that were in Islam. Now, the Sufi movement therefore was result of Hindu influence on Islam. The Sufi movement in all was actually the Hindu influence on Islam. This is the kind of thing that is important for this answer. This movement influenced both the Muslims and Hindus and thus provided a common platform for the two. Though the Sufis were devout Muslims, yet they differed from Orthodox Muslims. So I am continuously telling you that Islam was filled with orthodoxy and inadvertent ideas that were not complied with the thought process of Hindus here. So what happened was the ideas of Hindus and the ideas of Muslims, they were conjoined, and the conjoined idea or thought was actually called as Sufi movement. That is why we see Hindustani culture to be getting emergence from these thoughts. Interaction between the two not confined only to religion. In the realm of architecture, a mixed style called Indo-Islamic in music, a composite tradition with native Indian foreign Islamic tradition called Hindustani developed. Similar trend is found in painting and literature. So the culture involves many things like music, trends or traditions, painting, sculpture. So these are all the things that involve in involving architecture, or they also reframe the societal structure. So what happened was many things which were brought by Islam invaders that got involved in with Hindus who were living here, And when we saw the conjoined thing of Muslims and Hindus, we find that a mixed style of Indo-Islamic structure, a music which was of composite tradition of both Indian and foreign Islamic tradition, these all evolved at that particular time period after 13th century, 12th century. Okay. Now, we will continue with the answer. The Bhakti and Sufi saints preached and promoted a secular, tolerant and universal culture providing congenial atmosphere. Both accepted popular means like Sangeet and local languages in reaching out to the people. So, the basic part of this statement is related to how the Muslims and Hindus, when they were exercising their hobbies or they were inundating the habits that they had regarding the music and all that things, they were actually becoming a very popular part of the kind of conjoined culture that was being developed, which was Hindustani culture. Now, devotion means bhakti through which one can realize God. The chief exponent of this cult were Ramanuj, Nimbark, Ramanand, Vallabhacharya, Kabir, Nanak and Sri Chaitanya. So these were also the people who actually were from Hindu sect, Hindu religion, but did not conform with each and every aspect present in Hindus, and they were actually advocating a singular idolatry or a singular nature related bhakti that made them to be individual or isolated saints in a wider country where Hinduism was followed. Now, what they did was they preached the doctrine of love and devotion to realize God. Therefore, the movement came to be known as Bhakti movement. All right. So from here, you do know that Bhakti movement was also becoming very popular at the same time when the Sufi movement was becoming popular, and the confluence of the two were actually propounding or giving emergence to a new kind of culture that was Hindustani culture. The concept of bhakti or devotion to God was not new to Indians. We already know that in ancient times also we had many saints who were advocating about God. It is very much present in the Vedas, but it was not emphasized during the early period. The Ramayana and Mahabharata, though written earlier, were rewritten during the Gupta times. Therefore, bhakti was accepted along with Janan and Karma as one of the recognized roads to salvation. But this way was not popularized till the end of 14th century in India. So the bhakti movement was also a very important aspect where we can see that bhakti movement was trying to bring new things in the Hinduism itself, but it was slightly different than the exact position that Hinduism had. And many saints, like say for example Kabir, was actually a great, we could see in his teachings that he was actually a great confluence of Islamist and Hindu's ideas. Now, let's conclude the answer. And the conclusion would be, Bhakti movement has everlasting influence on the people of India and outside. Even Akbar the Great was greatly influenced by Bhakti and Sufi philosophers, which made him to follow a secular stand in the field of religion. So why did I expressed Akbar here was because Akbar was very much influenced about the ideas expressed by Islam and Hinduism both. And that is why he was very much enthusiastic about the religion. That is why he started Din Ilahi. He started a separate religion, which was called as Din Ilahi, because of Islam and Hinduism. So this is the overall answer for this particular question, because the question demanded about the confluence or the emergence of Hindustani culture because of Islam and Hindus. That is why we expressed about how the ideas from Islam and ideas from Hinduism conjoined into one, and then thereafter from the Hindu side, even from the Islam side, Hindustani culture was being developed. This is the overall summary of this particular question, and it could have been easily answered also. Let's move on to the other question. The question is, discuss the regional variations in the early South Indian temple architectural styles. It is about a particular region, that is early South Indian temple architectural styles. As you, as soon as you see the question, you get a few kind of architectures in your mind. Maybe that be of Nagara style, or maybe that be of Dravidian style, or you could get many ideas from the Cholas, Pandyas, and other rulers' architecture, the style of architecture that were being developed at particular time. So with this question, you can start with a kind of style, and thereafter explain the type of style, type of temple that was being developed then. And when you explain the style from there, you can explain how the regional variations were there in the South India. The regional variations, the question is expecting you to answer, what were the changes in the temple architecture from place to place? This is the main question that has to be answered. Now, what are the demand of the question? South Indian style architecture, architecture during Cholas, Pandyas, and other rulers, type of architecture, format of temple. Okay, so we will start with what the kind of temple were available in South India. The South India style of temple architecture is very distinct from that of the rest of India. It is convenient to resolve the type of architecture into four periods corresponding to the principal kingdoms that ruled in South India down the centuries, the Pallavas, Cholas, Pandyas, and Vijayanagara rulers. So these were the most prominent rulers during whose time temples were being built at a very rapid pace. Now, the earliest example of temple in the Dravidian style belonged to the Pallava period. So this is a fact that has to be expounded there. The temple architecture of the Pallavas is divided into two groups, rock cut Pallava rathas and structural. The greatest accomplishments of the Pallava architecture are the rock cut temples at Mahabalipuram. So this is the what did I do here is I actually expounded the great accomplishments of the Pallava architecture, which are rock cut temples, and where exactly it is located, that is at Mahabalipuram. So this is the regional variation that has been explained by me in the answer. The Cholas had built several hundreds of temples, the earliest example of which were modest in size, while the later ones were huge and large with Vimanas or Gopuras dominating the landscape. So what the Cholas did, Cholas were actually making hundreds of temples, numerous number of temples, which had Viman or Gopuras. This is also a kind of variation in the South India itself. An example to that would be the temple of Kuranganath at Srinivas Nallur in the Trichinopoly district of Tamil Nadu. This was the prominent region where Cholas were ruling. Built during the reign of Parantaka is one of the earliest example of Chola architecture. As I already told you that these were the kind of temples that were being developed during the time of Chola rulers. The combination of the grand style, however, was Brihadeshwar or Rajeshwar temple, which is located again in Tanjore, with the biggest temple complex and tallest Galivapura in India. So, as the question demands, the regional variation, a kind of variation has been explained, variation has been explained through the rock cut temple at Mahabalipuram. Thereafter, we moved on to Tanjore, that was Vimans and Gopuras type of temple. And later on also we come to a temple that is Kuranganath, which is also located at Trichinopoly. So different kinds of temples and different kinds of temple at different places is being explained throughout the answer. This is the main part of the answer that has to be presented. The Sundar Pandya Gopuram added to the temple of Jambukeshwar around 1250 AD and the Gopuram of the great temple at Kumbakonam are the best example of Gopurams of Pandyan times. So three different kinds of three different styles of temples have been explained at different places. This is the exact answer which was needed for this question. Okay. Temples erected by the Hoysala kings have a distinctive style of architecture. The Hoysala temples were star shaped with numerous angle projections. The carved surfaces are executed with remarkable precision, usually in chlorite. Again, there is a kind of change that is being explained here. Temples from the Hoysala period can be seen at Bellur, Helveshagar in Karnataka. So this is another kind of kingdom, and the expression that has been made is of different place, which is the demand of the question. The Vijayanagara rulers were great patrons of art and architecture. Scholars on the Vijayanagara style had three main regional styles of the art of South India: Dravidian style of the Cholas and Pandyas, the style of the Chalukya Hoysala tradition, and Indo-Islamic art of Bijapur region. So from this statement itself, a kind of question can be taken out, and those would be: which kind of southern ruler was very well interested in all the three different formats of temples, styles of temples that were available in South India? So that would be Vijayanagara rulers, and you will have to explain about what kind of temple architecture were they building during their time. Now, what were the speciality about the South Indian temple structure? We will just briefly explain it. It is not very much important, but you can explain it to score or see whether you get good marks there. South Indian temple structure are basically of five different shapes. Those are of square, usually called as kuta, and also katusar, rectangular or shal or ayasar, that is the name. Elliptical, called gajaprastha or elephant bat, also called vrityata, deriving from wagon vaulted shapes of apsidal chaityas with a horseshoe shaped entrance facade, usually called a nasi. So the best example could be the Hampi architecture. Circular or vritta, octagonal or astasra. So these are the types of shapes that are available. You can see these shapes in the present temples in the South India. So this is the basically different shapes that are available in the South Indian temple. Now I will be concluding this question with the Kalyan Mandap being the most conspicuous among the mandapas was a notable feature of the period. The temples also had Devi shrine to keep the replicas of the consort of the deity. Another noteworthy feature of the temple is the absence of mortar in their construction. So the best part about the temples were there absolutely was a kind of mandap where havans and other things could have happened, because many of the temples were also acting as educational institutions. So this was also a very prominent feature of temples that were available in South India. Then again, Devi shrine replica was also available in almost every temple. This is also a very distinct feature of South Indian temple architecture. So basically, what the question demands is about regional variations of temples that were available in South India. So we have already explained the numerous number of places and also the kind of temple that are located there. So this is the overall answer for this particular question. So we'll be moving on to the other question. The question is, Indian agriculture cannot survive without women, yet they are invisible in current conversation on the agrarian crisis. In this context, examine the role of women as farmer in India. So if you are attending society questions in the past, you would have seen that many questions are being asked from society, and the particular field that is being asked is that of women related. There are many questions which are related to women, and that forms part of society questions. So it will be very much beneficial if we include these kind of question in discussing our video. So what we should start with, the first thing is, it is about Indian agriculture. Indian agriculture cannot survive without women. This is the statement that is being made, and thereafter they are invisible in the current conversation on the agrarian crisis. The basic part, what the question demands is, it is wanting that how come when the women are very much important in agriculture, or when the women do huge work in the agriculture, how the talk of the women is absent when there is a kind of agrarian crisis in the country. In this context, examine the role of women as farmer. So what we have to do is, we will have to explain how women are very much important to the agriculture, also how they can help India get out of the agrarian crisis, and also we will have to tell that how the women are exercising their role as farmer, whereas they are not being they are being anonymous in the field of farmer as they are doing. Now let's start with the answer. Women cultivators and agriculture laborers perform about 70% of all the agricultural activities, yet their valuable contribution is ignored and they are not acknowledged as farmers. Now, women cultivators and agricultural laborers perform 70% of the agricultural activities. For around 70%, I would recommend that whenever you present a data, it should be having the backing of a source. If you do not want to put the source here, that is absolutely fine, but that has to be valid. Say, for example, if a kind of data has been put out by the agriculture ministry, or a kind of data has been put out by the women and child development ministry, the data of those ministries would only be valid. And if you have seen that a random organization NGO has put out a data, that NGO's name should be put out so that a government data could not be breached with. Okay, so this is the exact data which the agricultural ministry put out. Women cultivators and agricultural laborers perform about 70% of all the agricultural activities, yet their valuable contribution is ignored and they are not acknowledged as farmers. So this was not the statement that was included in the report of the agricultural ministry, but 70% of women are involved in agriculture is the statement that was made by the ministry. Now, in rural India, the percentage of women who depend on agriculture for their livelihood is as high as 84%. This is again the statistics that was presented by Agriculture Ministry. Women make up about 33% of cultivators and about 47% of agricultural laborers, yet they are nowhere in conversation of solving current agrarian crisis. It is time to recognize the efforts of women as farmers and work towards strengthening their role in agriculture. That is what the statement is being given, and these are the facts that are being put out from the Agriculture Ministry's report. Women make up around 33% of cultivators, 47% are agricultural laborers. So a large chunk of women are involved in agriculture. This is the overall depiction of this statement. So we are trying to explain the first part, which is Indian agriculture cannot survive without women. A large portion is involved in agriculture and women are part of that particular thing. Now, role of women in agriculture in India. The measurable increase of women's participation in agriculture sector and also in the proportion of households headed by women in rural areas. These women are de facto household heads because they care for both their families and the farm plots. So these are some of the statements that come from the report, Agriculture Ministry report itself, whether it be in annual report or other kinds of report that it publishes, because it always points out how or who exactly is handling the situation in the households of farmers. So it came up with the statement that women are highly involved in agrarian thing that happens in rural households. Now, gender division of labor in India, the typical work of female agricultural laborer or cultivator is limited to less skilled jobs such as sowing, transplanting, weeding and harvesting that often fit well within the framework of domestic life and child rearing. Many women also participate in agricultural work as unpaid subsistence labor. Now, gender division of labor in India, the typical work of female agricultural laborer. It is being said that limited to less skilled jobs because the prominent thing that happens in crop plantation is sowing or transplanting or weeding or harvesting. So these are the some of the things which are involved when one does agriculture. So women are also very prominently involved in doing these things, but because these are the kind of skill which are very much not needed these times, and there are many technologies that help farmers in doing these things, but women are actually, wherever there is need, women are the first group which is involved in all these things. Many women also participate in agricultural work as unpaid subsistence labor. So because there are many problem in our rural households, rural community, they, women are also working as subsistence labor in different other families. The woman must take charge in a natural role as caregiver, added domestic responsibilities, however, do not take away from her role in the fields where she is mostly assigned, the hard labor of sowing, seeding, threshing, harvesting, and ploughing. So women are doing both the works, that is handling the child at home or being a parent at home, and also doing the hard labor of sowing, seeding, because these are the things that may not be very tough, but it requires a lot amount of time. So that is becoming very much tough for the women. The traditional systematic denial of women as key producer in India's agriculture causes them to often be overlooked in the research and study, thus further entrenching exclusion of women in roles of agency. So it has been a traditional thing that women are not seen as the important person who were actually helping the male because of the patriarchal mindset or because of the thoughts that has persisted for a very long time. So these are the main reason why women are not involved in the conversation when conversation happened regarding the agrarian crisis. Now let's move on to the another part of the answer. However, women seldom get any representation or even recognition as agricultural worker despite the enormous work they perform. So this is the very important aspect, because women are never given representation whether in rural area or whether in urban area, because the male companion itself, they seems to be doing the large part, and that is why women's responsibility are overlooked, and this has persisted for very long. So it has become a kind of mindset of a society. So it will take a lot of time to remove this particular mindset. The reasons could be social bias, lack of education, freedom and opportunities accorded to them makes them independent, and hence they often find it difficult to raise their voices, either individually or even collectively. Dual responsibilities in their peak productive age group entails them with low skilled jobs and lesser wages. Lands or other assets are seldom registered in their names. So the social bias or the lack of education or the freedom that women do not have in our societies or the rural societies is a big hurdle in improving their status in rural household. So the basic thing is women do not have a very good place in our society, in the most specifically in rural societies. And because they are involved in agriculture vehemently, still their recognition is not being identified by the larger chunk of the society, which is becoming very difficult even for the government to point out. Now, in the conclusion, what we need to include would be role of women seems to be quite significant considering recent plight in agriculture sector. It's time to recognize and empower India's women farmers, but at the same time, their role must be widened. Their role must also be widened. They cannot be confined to agriculture or confined to a particular industry. Their need must be widened, and they must be given the opportunity to work in each and every field. SFG cooperatives, farmer producer cooperatives, Biotech Mahila Kisan scheme may play an efficient role too in reviving the agriculture sector. So these are the some of the kind of schemes that could help in reviving agriculture sector with the help of women, because a larger chunk of women are involved in agriculture as well. So what did I do in the presentation of the answer was I put out the data from the agriculture reports. You can find all the data in a very simple book that are being produced by institutions. Even we produce it, you can get the data from there. The reports produce kind of data regarding male, female, how many kind of labor are involved in agriculture, what are the percentage of laborers that are involved in agriculture, who are the males, who are the females. So these data are already being put out by the agriculture ministry in its report, or even different kinds of ministries are putting it out. From there, we can find that women are being ignored for the work that they are doing in agriculture. This was the question, and we have justified it. We have justified the statement, and we have also examined the role of women as farmer in India. What we did was we stated that there are some percentage of women who are involved in agriculture. Then we stated that what is the role of women in agriculture when women is also actually handling the parental thing and also simultaneously working at the fields. These are the two important aspects that were discussed here. Whereas also we discussed the reasons why they are not being recognized and why the aspect that they are working hard in the agricultural part is not being recognized by the society. We also discussed that. At the conclusion part, we said that a kind of scheme must be developed with the help of women, because they are a large chunk in working in the field of agriculture. So a kind of self-help group or kind of scheme could be very much beneficial for the agriculture sector with the help of women. So this is the best answer that could be put out for these kind of questions. I hope that you did get many things from these videos that we have, this video that I have put out for the Indian History Society and Art and Architecture. These are the five questions that I was to discuss in this particular video. I will be coming up with many videos in the further coming days, and you can get as much help as you want for your mains preparation. So thank you for watching this. Stay home, stay safe, and keep learning.